Welcome all of you to the Arthur Lewis Centenary Lecture, the inaugural lecture in what we hope will become an annual public lecture series. And for our first lecture, it's our very great pleasure, on behalf of the School of Social Sciences, to welcome Jim O'Neill, who's Honorary Professor of Economics, to deliver the lecture today, The Complex and Changing World Economy. At this point, I'm going to hand over to James Thompson, who's Associate Vice President for Social Responsibility, who's been working very closely with the school in order to develop this program and to help us put on the celebrations today in honor of Arthur Lewis's centenary. James.
Thanks very much, Chris. Thank you very much. I'm delighted to welcome Professor Jim O'Neill to give tonight's Arthur Lewis Centenary Lecture in his position as newly appointed Honorary Professor of Economics. This centenary lecture is a celebration of the contribution of Arthur Lewis to the university, to his field, and to the wider Manchester community. When he joined the University of Manchester in 1948, he became Britain's first black professor. Arthur Lewis is best known as one of the founders of development economics, and he went on to complete most of his important work here. In 1979, he was awarded the Nobel Prize for Economics. But it's also important to note that Professor Lewis was committed to work in the local community, particularly supporting the newly arrived Afro-Caribbean communities in Mossside. It was fitting that the university named its new social science building after him, a building that since 2004 has been home to the disciplines of economics, politics, sociology, social anthropology, and philosophy in the School of Social Science, and then Geography, the Institute of Development Policy and Management, the Brookswell Poverty Institute in the School of Environment, Education and Development. And this leads me to Professor Jim O'Neill. His lecture tonight and wider contribution to the university is an excellent opportunity for staff and students to engage with a truly world-leading economist, and crucially for us, one that has strong roots in the city and the region. Professor O'Neill was brought up in Gatley, Manchester. He's chair of the Greater Manchester Local Enterprise Partnership Advisory Board and, sadly for me, a lifelong Manchester United fan. Oh dear. Jim O'Neill worked for Goldman Sachs between 1995 and 2013 and was chairman of Goldman Sachs. Goldman Sachs, Man United, with anyway. And he was the firm's chief economist between 2001 and 2011. Before joining Goldman Sachs, he was head of the global research at the Swiss Bank Corporation. Professor O'Neill is famously coined the term BRIC economies in a 2001 paper, predicting that Brazil, Russia, India, and China would become future powerhouses of the world economy. The acronym has been widely used to symbolize a shift in global economic power away from the G7 economies towards the developing world. He has recently presented four programs on BBC Radio 4 on what he predicts will be the next group of growing economies, which he calls the MINT countries: Mexico, Indonesia, Nigeria, and Turkey. I want to add a quick word about honorary roles in the university. In the last couple of years, the Faculty of Humanities has made a number of appointments to this title, from Toby Jones, the award-winning actor and alumni of the university, who's in the audience with us tonight, to Shami Chakrabarty, the director of Liberty, to Jim O'Neill here. You might wonder, what is the connection between a world-renowned economist, a dynamic human rights lawyer, and a Golden Globe nominated actor? And for the younger audience members, he's also the voice of Dobby the house elf in the Harry Potter films. The connection between them is not simply that they've agreed to do a job that is in effect unpaid. In fact, they exemplify the direction that universities have moved in the last years. Researchers more than ever are interested in understanding how their efforts make a positive impact or difference to the wider world, whether in the social sciences, the cultural fields, technical or scientific areas. And they do their research in partnership with public bodies, private companies, and the cultural sector. Similarly, universities more than ever are interested in welcoming external partners onto our campuses to improve student experience, to collaborate on research, or to work to support our engagement with local communities. There is a growing acceptance of the idea that the membrane between the university and the wider world is and should be permeable. And our honorees are the exemplars of this. They exist simultaneously within and beyond the campus. They extend our research, expand the opportunity for our students, and make our institution a place where seeking to make a difference to the wider world is the norm. So once again, thanks for coming. Thanks to Professor O'Neill for delivering tonight's Arthur Lewis Centenary Lecture. We very much look forward to it. Thank you.
Okay, can you also hear me at the back, clearly? Good. Well, this is an absolutely huge privilege for me to be here with all of you tonight. Obviously, I have quite a lot of awareness of the incredible contribution that Arthur Lewis gave to development economics. But I have to say, until a few weeks ago, until I really focused on this beautiful day in which his legacy has been recognized with the mural that was unveiled, which I had the pleasure of doing, I hadn't fully appreciated how much he had done for the community of Manchester. And as a proud Mancunian that was schooled in Withinshaw, which is a pretty tough neighborhood of Manchester, before going to Burnage, things like that resonate a lot and have a lot of influence on my life. So hearing what one of the biographers was saying earlier about the way he thought, it is quite incredible to think of the things he did for Hume and Moss Side in 1953, I think was the date that was mentioned, which was actually 4 years before I even appeared into this planet. And it's fantastic to celebrate that. It's a great tribute. I cannot resist adding this flavor to it as somebody that, with my football allegiances, loves to have a go at Liverpool more than Manchester City still. That it turns out Liverpool declined a chance of making him a professor. So they get everything wrong in that place. Apologies to any of you that are from Liverpool. Actually, I thought, given what James said there, I'd also start by asking two questions of you all. First of all, linked to how I present some of my slides, just a quick show of hands. How many of you here have or are studying the dreaded world of economics? Or how many of you are bold enough to acknowledge that that's what you waste your time on? Not that many, okay. That's interesting. Second thing is, how many people here support Manchester City? How many people support United? There you go. Are there any Liverpool fans? One over there, one here. Did I see one there too? No. One here. I'm not going to do any more until those three people are removed from the premises. Okay. So I'm going to plan to show some slides for about maybe 40 minutes. And then leave as much time as you guys want to take on a Tuesday evening to ask me questions. And there are so many things that I could talk about linked to this very broad topic that I deliberately set, the complex and changing world economy. But there are sort of five central things and themes that I will kind of base my presentation around. The first of which, linked to the exact title, I don't really think, and it's understandable that that's the case, that many people really understand the scale and degree of the change of the world economy that is taking place today, including lots of people in academia and in business. One of the many reasons is because the scale of that change is so vast by the standards of history, particularly when we've had economic data. The second thing which I'll say about that is that I think some of it is sort of partly generational, because especially for people raised in my generation or perhaps somewhat older, we are very used to a world in which the sort of US is the place and all these other places don't really matter. And so there's a bit of a mental thing which intersperses with natures of society and democracy that also add to this complexity and maybe even acceptability of how the world's changing. The second thing I'm going to spend a little bit of time on is to talk about briefly and show you some pictures of what's going on with what I call the world economic cycle. So sort of what's going on in the short term and the momentum post-crisis. Thought I'd spend a little bit of time with that, and I'll talk a bit about the so-called developed world. Thirdly, linked to the sort of core thesis, I'll spend quite a bit of time about the critical interplay between the US and China, the two biggest economies in the world today, and try to explain that another way of looking at the decade we have entered, really, is how those two countries are evolving from the crisis and whether they are managing to structurally change as we slowly emerge from those pretty severe challenges of 2008. The fourth thing to specifically follow on from that is, if it's not complex enough, very importantly in my opinion, and it's fascinating in this regard to see so many people of what I'd say it looks like Greater China in this room, if it's not complicated enough, I believe that we are in the early stages of what I call a new China. And trying to understand the world in the rest of this decade and Chinese economic policies is not so easy, because it's a different China than the one that has become so important to the world of the past 15, 20 years. And I'll explain a bit about that. And then lastly, even though they're the most two important places in the world, they're not the only places of importance. There's 205 countries in the world, or there or thereabouts, of which my brick and mints are eight places that I'm quite fond of. So I'll say a little bit about a couple of those places, but I will not really do justice to the amount of time I could spend on any of them. To say just one example, I believe India may be a place that finally positively surprises people, particularly following the election of Mr. Modi, which certainly gives India, in my judgment, a chance to have more effective governance, to distinguish it from a lot of government. If I may explore that more in Q&A. So here's my first picture. Can you see at the back these numbers okay? Okay, well, I kind of think that's good. Sometimes I kind of like it if people can't, so I can just ramble on about whatever I want. So in many ways, linked to my first of the five themes, in many ways, this is the most important chart I'm showing you. And so I'll spend a bit of time on it with about five different key points I want to try and show. So what it shows you is economic growth, the percentage GDP growth, by mainly region and the world as a whole, and by some slightly odd acronyms at the bottom, for the past or the previous three decades, this decade to date, and what the last column on the right, as you look at it, is what I had and still broadly assume would happen this decade based on how I understand this complex changing world. So the first point, and linked to what I said, how I don't think many people truly understand how the world is evolving, contrary to what most people think, actually, the last decade, 2001 to 2010, world GDP growth was stronger than the previous two decades. I would suggest to you that probably 95% of professional people that I deal with, and a lot of people that look at international economic issues, don't actually really realize that that's the case. And of course, there's good reasons why they have that in their head, because the last decade was very turbulent, particularly for Western economies. We had the granddaddy of all financial crises in 2008-2009, as many people quite rightly think, possibly the worst economic and financial crisis since the Great Depression. And of course, we had already had the bursting of the TMT bubble and all that went with that in 2000-2001. Despite that, world GDP growth was 3.7%, faster than the previous two decades. So that's my first point. Linked to that, and reasons I'll get into in my other points, I had assumed, because of the reasons why it was faster, and in particular, the emergence of China and other large emerging nations, this decade, the world's potential was to grow by just over 4%. Second thing to say, and why is that the case, is because of this remarkable thing called China. I could spend hours just talking about China itself, and I say that because, not because there's a lot of people in the room from China, especially because quite a few of you were the ones that put your hands up to Manchester United fans. Please help me get rid of the Glazers, but then, that's another topic. Very importantly, I believe there is nothing quite like the phenomena in terms of its global relevance of China today. And not only going back to my central theme about how complex it is for everybody, I think that includes also for a lot of Chinese people, including Chinese policymakers. A lot of Chinese policymakers that I come across don't truly understand how dramatically China's influence on world economic affairs already is. And I'll just give you a couple of examples, and I'll come back to talk about this. Today, China is on its way to being an economy worth $10 trillion. At the end of this year, it'll be about $10 trillion in US dollars. That means it's 1.5 times as big as the other three BRIC countries put together. As I wrote in a piece I wrote, I occasionally write for Bloomberg Financial, whatever they are, in the controversy about what's going on in Hong Kong, I controversially wrote something saying that I think it's very important that people in the UK that want to tell China how Hong Kong should be run. These days, China creates three more Hong Kongs every year. When I first started thinking about China, it was about the same size as Hong Kong. And it's very important when people are imparting all this wisdom about China that they realize the kind of context of how they should be thinking about it. China, at close to $10 trillion, is bigger than Germany, France, and Italy put together. So for us in the UK, with all the complexities of issues about the importance of Europe and what is our stance on the EU, I have, because of the experience of following this, have actually shifted my personal opinions a little. I think it's very important and would be great if we do stay in the EU, but we cannot have, in order to preserve the EU the way that many continental countries probably would prefer, to be constrained by things they might do that would stop us from exploring all these opportunities with places in particular like China. And I'll talk more about some aspects of that later. I say all of that because the third thing to point out, I'm talking to you at a time where it is highly fashionable for and very amusing for me as being Mr. Brick to observe all these people that now write about how ridiculous the BRICS concept was, and it, you know, it never made any sense, and it certainly doesn't make any sense now because they've all got all these problems, and etc., etc., etc. Which takes me to say something very briefly about the BRICS as a group for now, and something about each of them individually. So one of the reasons why the whole BRICS thesis became so slightly oddly as popular as it did is because I think we were the first group of people that in any simple detail spelt out by five-year periods how the world could economically emerge up to 2050. And we made assumptions about two things, and I'm going to come back to talk about this later in my last of my fifth comment. Long-term economic growth is driven by the number of people that work and their productivity. So we made assumptions about those things throughout what was initially when we did it, nearly 40 years. And so we spent a lot of time thinking about how working age demographics and productivity may change in each of the BRIC countries. We certainly, and I certainly didn't, assume that what was going on last decade would go on forever in all four. And I find it in particularly really quite amusing that many people express views about China having serious problems because its economy is slowing. I would put it to you, and I'll come back to this as my third point. I think the main reason, there are other reasons, but the main reason why China's economy has slowed is because the Chinese policymakers have deliberately slowed it. Because they are trying to pursue what I've called a new China, which is focused on the better quality of growth as opposed to just quantity of growth. And if you look at these numbers, and very importantly, actually of the four BRIC countries, China is the only one so far this decade which is growing by more than I assumed 3 years ago. So China isn't disappointing me yet at all, if economic growth is a yardstick of things that are important. There's people in this room that I'm sure have plenty of views on whether that indeed is the case, but we'll leave that topic for now. Because China's grown by 8.2%, I assume 7.5%. In the aggregate of the BRICS, because, as I said earlier, China's now so big, actually, decade to date, the BRICS countries have grown exactly, or 0.1% less than I have assumed. And if you put it in a geopolitical context, this notion that the BRICS are sort of no longer as relevant and it was a crazy idea, that suggests it's really kind of stupid. And indeed, if you just look at the next couple of years, probably by the end of 2016, possibly before, the BRICS countries collectively will be bigger than the United States, even with the challenges that are going on in each of the other three. And I would say for now, and I could talk a lot about the BRICS Development Bank, I'll leave that to Q&A as well, but I would say, and you can see from these numbers, both Brazil and Russia in particular are, so far this decade, very disappointing. And there's a pretty straightforward reason as to why both are, even though they each have their own reasons. They are, of course, major commodity producers. And surprise, surprise, it is indeed the case. These places seemed so great when commodity prices were rising every day for the best part of a decade. But we've entered a period where commodity prices have now gone down for quite a while. And as is often referred to as the so-called Dutch disease, both those places are exhibiting many symptoms of being far too dependent on commodities. Now, that doesn't mean to say, as many people now popularly write, both you can forget about Brazil and Russia for the rest of mankind, not least because I'd point out to you, as disappointing as Brazil's 2% growth has been the first 3 years of this decade, guess what? It's actually slightly higher than it was in the first 3 years of the last decade. And I introduced the BRIC acronym bang in the middle of that when people, including many people in Brazil, thought I was completely insane for even contemplating including the B, because all you ever knew that Brazil had a crisis. And I frequently these days joke with a lot of Brazilian people that they themselves are like some kind of reverse indicator of what's actually going on in Brazil, because the next few years, Brazil accelerated to very strong rates of growth, and then the same people were trying to tell me I was some kind of genius when all it really was commodity prices going up and down. What they have both obviously got to do is to adjust themselves to not be so dependent on the fortunes of commodity prices and things related to commodities for their countries, which is easier said than done. Two other quick things, and I won't spend anything like as much time on the rest of the slides, you'll be kind of pleased to know. As important as those countries are at the core of this changing complexity of the world, there are the so-called mint countries, which are four of this weird-looking crowd, the N11. And two minutes on that. After about 3 years of the BRIC acronym, I used to get so many people writing to us, and a lot of journalists, but a lot of intellects, saying, why just those four countries? Why not Mexico? Why not Indonesia? Why not Africa? Why not the Middle East? Et cetera, et cetera. So we wrote a paper entitled, How Solid Are the BRICS? And in it, we looked at the potential for the next 11 being the numbers of players in a football team. I don't know why we chose 11, but we chose 11. These are the next 11 largest populated emerging countries, and we looked for each of them at their specific potential to be as big as a brick, which even by that stage, I started to refine the what distinguishes a brick country from another. It is one that is either already 5% of global GDP or has a realistic chance of being that in the next couple of decades. And that's what this next 11 group are. The four mint countries are nothing other than four of those. And that's kind of the end of the wisdom of the mint countries, at least for now, till I come back to the end. Final thing, so far this decade, the world's growing at 3.3. And we all read, my goodness me, do we all read about all the complexities and scary things about how weak it is. It's actually the same as the previous two decades before the last one. It is nowhere near the 4.1% I have assumed. The main reason is because of our dear friends in the Eurozone. I could also spend the whole night, in fact, probably the whole of the rest of my life, talking about the Eurozone and its economic issues. But two things. The Eurozone has got increasingly weak potential because on the two criteria that I believe drive long-term economic growth, working age population, which is demographics. As most people know, continental Europe's demographics are really poor. And secondly, they've got increasing productivity challenges. Both of them are really bad ingredients for economic growth. So the euro area's growth potential is declining. If that weren't challenging enough, because of the many, many problems that have come out of the eurozone's crisis, as you can see, so far this decade, eurozone growth is nowhere near, in fact, it's close to non-existent. And that is the main reason why the world economy is not delivering today the potential that I've assumed. And I can talk a lot more about that. So there's the kind of first scene setting, and it connects a lot of now what's going to follow. So very quickly, in terms, I said the second thing, a bit of where we are in the world cycle. And one of the things I did for the best part of my decade plus of running our economics research group at Goldman Sachs is try to make sure that we could build analytical tools with the amount of resources we had that were proprietary, but also we hoped useful for our clients, that would be very difficult for our competitors to do. And so we had a lot of things that include a lot of business surveys, and we played around with them ourselves. What I say that because, and this is nothing to do with Goldman Sachs, JP Morgan own the licensing for this, that every month there is something called the Purchasing Managers Index, and many, many countries around the world publish it on the first day, the manufacturing one is on the first day of the month, every month. And 2 days later, depending on a weekend or not, the services sector one comes out too. This is the JP Morgan manufacturing one. In my view, this is a superb snapshot of what the world looks like economically as soon as the month has finished. So that 52.58 is the reading for the month of, we are in September now, right? August, when it was published on September the 1st. So it's very up to date. And I show it you here going back decade to date, and it sort of depicts what feels to me to be the general state of the world, that we sort of keep trying to recover significant momentum globally as we try to distance ourselves from the shock of 08-09. But every now and then, something seems to happen somewhere that kind of pulls us back down. So to me, the world sort of seems a bit like, cyclically, two steps forward, one step back. A lot of those steps back are because of the issues going on in the Eurozone. The United States, as is a sort of widely shared amongst those that follow these things relatively closely, it's slightly scary consensus that cyclically the US is on the way back. But remember those days of 5.5 years ago where people thought the United States was finished forever? Doesn't look like it. Linked to the somewhat worrying theme I've said about the Eurozone, it's got a lot of structural dilemmas. Its cyclical picture doesn't look great either. This is the Eurozone Purchasing Managers Index. We just had what's called a flash Purchasing Managers Index for this month published today, which has weakened a bit further. And what is, without getting into the boring detail about it, one of the reasons why these surveys are so important is they are very, generally speaking, really useful and quite accurate 3 to 6 month leading indicators of industrial production and broader economic activity. Now, the next chart is this one, is that has not been the case for the past 2 years for Europe or the Eurozone. And an additional worrying thing is that these business surveys have been over-predicting what has subsequently happened with industrial production in Europe. And it might be suggestive, as many analysts conclude, of problems in the financial system relating to the fact that the Eurozone can't get away from the mess of their own crisis, which, interestingly, if you want to get into these kind of debates, is quite, at a minimum, amusing when it's the Eurozone intellectual leaders are happily criticizing American and British finance for causing all these problems, where it doesn't look like that's causing so many problems in the US and the UK anymore, but plenty of lingering problems for them. And it's rather interesting that in the very latest month, after showing a very strong recovery last year, UK one has slowed. Now, this is just the manufacturing purchasing index. The services sector one continues to be very, very strong. But of the two, even though it only relates to manufacturing, it's actually got some properties of predictive power beyond manufacturing. And this is a sign to me that some of the power of the UK recovery momentum might be easing a little bit. And I could go on and on and on. The place where I'd show you one other is China. Here is the Chinese Producer Purchasing Manager Index 2. A topic I get, anticipating a question, one of the earliest ones I always get when I talk at an audience like this, do you believe Chinese data? Don't you think they deliberately fiddle it to make it look good? Not done a very good job with that if they do, have they? China has been slowing down on a whole range of quite credible indicators, including this one, for 3 years. Very interestingly, cyclically, and those of you that follow financial markets closely, you will observe that the markets seem to recognize this because Chinese-related markets have traded quite a bit better the past couple of months. There's some signs of some kind of cyclical bounce going on in China. So there's a sort of my second bit, the cyclical state of the world. Two steps forward, one step back, and it's because there's a lot of momentum helped by very generous monetary policy and in some places quite generous fiscal policy, but there's things going on all over the place that seem to sort of bring us one step back. Now let me go, I'll come back to those. Now let me go to the third thing I said. That at the core of how I think about the world is the US and China. And what happens to those two places is essentially critical for everybody else. And I often think a way of looking at the horror of 2008 and 2009, in essence, is because the United States had a personal savings rate of zero, and it was against a background that sort of started with President Clinton, went through President Bush, and sort of cajoled, let's call it, into the central bank being run by Alan Greenspan at the time, this sort of underlying, very admirable social theme, and it's part of the American dream, everybody should be able to own their own house. And in essence, what was sort of going on, the US was borrowing more and more money from the rest of the world to finance what seemed to some not very focused observers a never-ending rise of US house prices. And one way of measuring that is through the balance of payments. If you just focus on the red line, which is the balance of payments current accounts, for those of you not trained in the dismal world or the dismal science, the current account balance in some ways is nothing other than a measure of the difference between how much a country saves and how much it invests. So quite often, countries that have really low savings rates are typically ones that have big current account deficits because you have to borrow or may find it easy to borrow from the rest of the world. So the US went into this global credit crisis with a current account deficit of 6.5% of GDP. And essentially, indirectly through a very sophisticated, increasingly complex financial intermediation system, US householders were borrowing all this money from the rest of the world to allow them to buy these houses. And of course, it went wrong. A test of how the US is structurally dealing with the post-crisis world is what's going on with the current account deficit. And here we are, what is it, five and a bit, nearly 6 years later. The US current account deficit is now nearly down to 2% of GDP. For a large part of my earlier two-thirds career pre-BRIC in the city, I spent a lot of time looking at financial markets and foreign exchange and theories about international trade and determination of current accounts and currencies. And it was widespread judgment, and was still until very recently, the US could only have a current account deficit of less than 3% of GDP if it was almost permanently in recession. I just showed you their Purchasing Managers Index showing a significant acceleration, and their current account deficit is nearly a third of what it was 6 years ago. So that suggests to me, and it amazes me that some prominent economics media people don't write about this more, that suggests to me the US is emerging from the mess of that period as a pretty different place than it was. Surprise, surprise, flip side of that is my friends in China. US saved nothing, China has a savings rate of 50% of GDP. One way of measuring that for people that understandably think there's all sorts of problems with Chinese data is, of course, the balance of payments data, both theirs and other countries that do trade with China. I don't think you can accuse everybody of fiddling data in China's favor, but some people try and do that. China had a current account surplus, the opposite of the US, of nearly 10% of GDP going into the crisis. Today, it's about 2%. So another thing I would suggest to the minds of those that focus worryingly on China slowing, China slowed from 10 to 7-ish. In that period, its current account surplus, which was fed by, let me call it the drug of cheap, low value added exports, has gone from 10% of GDP to 2. That's, I think, a pretty good outcome so far from what the world sort of needs in dealing with this remarkable thing called China, if it's sustainable and reflective of things going on internally. Go from that now to my fourth points. If it's not complicated enough, I believe that what I've just introduced there and now developed some more time on is we are looking at a very different sort of China now and going forward than the one that I've spent a lot of my life on, and a one that many of us have in our minds as its relevance to the rest of the world. So we all think, typically in the West, of China being a very cheap place to import things from. Lots of British retailers have had their success because of that. Although, look at some of the things one of Britain's greatest retailers, Philip Green, is saying these days. He finds it difficult to get things as cheaply from China. Surprise, surprise. Famous story of the noodle producer in York that is now bringing everything back from being produced in China because it's cheaper to do it in York. Many other such stories. And I'll explain a bit more about what's going on policy-wise in my judgment related to this. But let me spend a tiny minute on this chart. I showed you the balance of payments side of it. What you see here is something that I follow or try to follow really closely every month as a monitoring guide of what I call the new China. It is the ratio of retail sales spending, which is a monthly guide of consumer spending, relative to industrial production. So it's a measure of what China consumes relative to what it produces. That's the sort of simple way of thinking about it. And if the line's going up, that suggests China's changing. And in my opinion, the rest of the world should be really focused on this rather than what China's GDP is, because we don't interact with China's GDP. We interact with what Chinese people want to consume, and hopefully including stuff that we might want to export, and what they produce and try and sell to us. That's how we, I believe, should engage about it. And of course, for China themselves, particularly as one of the core reasons I think this model has been deliberately orchestrated by Chinese policymakers, is linked to their own social philosophy. The last great phase of China in the early BRIC stages actually resulted or coincided with a huge growth of inequality, which doesn't really fit with the Chinese philosophy. And so they are doing a number of things to sort of try and change that. And as it relates to this, is deliberately raising wages for the lowest income people as one of many efforts to try and boost consumption. Now, what is particularly interesting and very fortuitous for me to show you this picture, in the absolute latest data, where so many people are again focused on the big slowdown in China because industrial production was surprisingly soft. Another big philosophical thing for people that think Chinese policymakers deliberately distort Chinese data. Why didn't they do it with that? But against that, the actual retail sales numbers are holding up very well. And that is despite what appears to be an accelerating clampdown on what I'd call illicit luxury gifting. And so China seems to be making some progress, albeit quite erratic, in the right direction for itself, and in my opinion, a healthier direction for the rest of the world. And I don't have too much time to focus on it now, maybe again come up in Q&A. It seems to me that the winners and losers of the new China are probably going to be pretty different than the winners and losers of the old China or more recent China. For example, and an issue within the BRICS for Brazil and Russia because they're commodity producers, because China is no longer going to be such a big low value added manufacturer and there's not going to be so much investment in that kind of stuff. And tangential to this, there is huge focus on things to improve the efficiency of energy usage and, of course, the environment of urban China. They don't really want to support as many polluting industries and energy and commodity sapping industries. So broadly speaking, and it's not as simple as I'm going to say, I think other commodity producing nations and commodity producing companies are probably quite significant losers of the new China. And of course, they were amongst the biggest winners of the old China. And so within business and for economic policymakers, this is quite a dilemma because, of course, people tend to get a little bit lazy because they just think whatever's going on will go on forever. And so for Brazil and Russia within the BRICS, for Australia, the country that seemingly the past 20 years never got anything wrong and never have any economic challenges again, suddenly things don't look so great because this big juggernaut that was sucking in all commodities from Australia isn't doing so much anymore. Going back to something I touched on about for the UK, I believe as we creep more and more through time, the new China is going to want to be attracted by not just Louis Vuitton bags, but more broader forms of higher value consumer and service related goods, which should be a really good and better opportunity for the UK to sell stuff to China than this past period was. And when I mentioned earlier about this piece I'd written about Hong Kong, I think it is really important, and I know what I'm saying now is going to be controversial, that UK policymakers have to distinguish carefully between what they might intellectually think should happen in Hong Kong, but trying to stamp their judgment on what they believe China should specifically do. Because if you want to explore, as this coalition and our Prime Minister in particular has very consciously and engagingly done, I was on part of the official trip to China last December, you've got to be careful about those things. Because they don't want you to tell them how to run their life. And if you want to be part of this, you've got to respect that. So, that leaves me with jumping forward my last and fifth comment, where I'm just going to say a little bit more about some of these other new places that I've talked about a lot about and seemingly of more interest to the world. And I'll be no more than 5 minutes. And I'll start going back to what I said earlier twice. I believe economic growth is essentially driven by the number of people that work, long-term economic growth, the size of the working population, and its productivity. What you see on the left is the 15 largest economies in the world today by dollar GDP, and on the right, the 15 largest economies potentially in 2050, if countries improve their productivity. And I have to say, I've not said anything further from my introductory comments. It would be fascinating if Arthur Lewis was still alive today to know what he would think about this, because I think he was probably thinking quite a bit about the Caribbean behind some of his brilliant mind. But in essence, some of these countries that could become so important are actually already living examples, China being the greatest, of what his philosophy and what he got his Nobel Prize all about. And it's going back to what I also said about my generation or elder ones, this is like, oh my God, this is weird. China, much bigger than the United States. India and Brazil, potential to be bigger than Japan. I deliberately manipulated it so that we're still in the top 10. That's not true. We have, relative to other developed countries, very good demographics. And most intriguingly, my friends in Africa, the N in Mint, which is why I focused on them, a country that is already 15% of Africa's population. And if that highly complex, mad country can stay together as one, their potential is huge. If. There's lots of ifs, if anybody who heard the program would have hopefully heard me saying. It's a country that I've spent a lot of time in the past 2 years linked to that. So I can be rude about Nigeria because I spend a lot of time there. But it's very exciting. Jump to this chart. The easy bit is the demographics. in some ways. The tough bit is the productivity. And let me spend a couple of closing minutes with this, then I'm going to stop. VSG stands for Variables for Sustainable Growth. It is an index that I recently created with a consultant that worked for Edimar Consultancy, a very small specialist but excellent economic consultancy, that linked to some of the research I'd presided over in my life at Goldman Sachs. We used to have something called growth environment scores. This is, and they still do. This is, I can't keep talking of Goldman stuff because I'm not there. This is something similar. And what it is, it's an index that goes from 0 to 10 of about 15, 16 variables that are relevant for productivity. I used to joke when Manchester United were good that 10 was the Manchester United of VSGs. I guess today I have to say it's like the Bayern Munich. And there you go, there's a Bayern Munich fan there. So 10's like really good, and of course nobody's 10. And 0 is kind of like you don't want to be anywhere near 0. And what you see here is the VSG scores for the 15 largest emerging economies in the world, the four BRIC countries and the next 11. Four quick points, then I'll stop. South Korea, anybody here from South Korea? No. South Korea, in my judgment, in terms of economics and development, is probably the single most interesting country in the world during my professional career. Because it is the only country of more than 40 million people that has successfully made the transition to a relatively wealthy country. When I was first starting to join international finance in the city in 1982, the wealth of South Korea was the same as most African countries. Today, South Korea has the wealth not far behind Portugal and not too far off Italy. They are the only country of more than 40 million people who have done that. It may be coincidence, but they score really highly in this. With this colleague of mine, we have this for over 150 countries. South Korea is one of the top scoring countries in the world. And going back to my title and the thesis, why on earth do we call South Korea an emerging economy? It is ridiculous. On some of these subcomponents, such as use of technology, four of the variables relate to technology and education, they score right at the top of standards compared to the best of the West. So there's the first point. Second point linked to that, when, as many policymakers do from all these other countries, say, what do I need to do to get better? My simple answer is get on a plane, go to Seoul, South Korea, figure out how they've managed to do it, and see what bit they have done that you can adapt and use for your society. Because they've somehow managed to do something that has transformed the health and wealth of 45 million South Koreans, or maybe a few more. Third point, contrary to the thousands of emails I get every other month, when are you going to drop the R in BRIC because Russia kind of sucks? I guess it does suck a lot right now, but on these kind of criteria, as this shows you, it is not the weakest of the four BRIC countries. India is the weakest. And I'm sort of a bit schizophrenic about India frequently because of their demographic profile, they have the best potential in terms of rates of economic growth. Just as a quick throwaway, on some of the work I've done, and I'm sure there's people here that have studied this kind of stuff in detail, between now and 2030, just the increase in India's working population, just the increase could be as big as the existing working population of Italy, France, and Spain put together. So if they ever did things to get their productivity sorted out, wow. But of course, it's a big if. But that's why I say electing, as I said earlier on, electing Mr. Modi is a big deal, because that could change it. But India, Russia's really bad at the stuff we know Russia's really bad at, but it's actually better on a couple of things than people give them credit for, including, importantly, use of technology. Final thing before last, what about everywhere else? And I'll say, a lot of people often say to me, well, how you talk about it, why don't you talk about Africa? What about the Middle East? I'll finish with comments on those. My dear friends in Nigeria, surprise, surprise, are the lowest of the 15 on all these things. So Nigeria has got to do a lot of big things. What is interesting, however, if you look more closely at the yellow shading, this is the change in those scores since we can find comparable data going back for the construction of them all. If you look at the actual absolute change, Nigeria has made quite a bit of progress, and certainly more than Bangladesh, Pakistan, or Egypt. And so they're going in the right direction, despite the place being completely chaotic and mad. And if they continue with this progress, albeit haphazard, and if we met today, 16 years from today, my guess is people will be thinking of Nigeria in a lot more positive spirits than they kind of do today, because they're going in the right direction from a dreadfully low base. And all of that is really important because given their population dynamics, and if they stay together as one place, 2050, Nigeria will have more people than the United States. And it will be more than 20% of Africa's population, if the place can stay together as one country. And then lastly, on the Middle East, there are, in this kind of analysis, there are only really two countries that register as having the potential to be big, because a lot of it's to do with how many people you've got. And it's none of the Gulf countries. Most of the Gulf countries are really small. They are all, of course, really wealthy, or most of them are. But Egypt and Iran immediately appear on the radar because they have a lot of people, which is why some of the things playing out in that very complex part of the world are so interesting. And what is kind of really intriguing to me is that if you look at one of these very simple scoring things, actually Iran doesn't do that bad. And if they ever had some kind of major shift of philosophy at the top, I think Iran could quite quickly start to appear as a very different place in the next decade or so than is generally thought about today. So why not stop there? Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. A challenge and a question. You put up lots of graphs, and some go up and some go down, but there's a graph that I'm thinking of that goes up every year without fail, and it went up this year a little bit faster than previous years. I'm referring to the Keeling curve that shows the concentration of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, and that goes up and up and up, and there's talk of relative decoupling of economies, but it goes up and up and up. And the climate scientists have said, basically, that we've kissed goodbye to keeping the temperature rise to 2 degrees above pre-industrial levels, and we're likely to hit 4. Mm. And that will have, as you know, enormous implications for at least agriculture. So my challenge is to you to include the Keeling curve in this presentation. And my question is almost an investment question.
Ooh.
If I had 10 million quid, and well, I wish, and I wanted to invest it somewhere that was safe, would I invest it in Peabody Energy, or would I invest it in any of the Australian coal mining companies that have built these enormous mines and ports to flog to China? But that seems to me like the mother of all stranded assets. I don't know if you agree or disagree.
I think you answered your own second question, didn't you?
What about the first question?
If you've got 10 million quid,
no, you
should put it in a fund that links to something that I believe was talked about called the Red Knights, for the eventual saviour of Manchester United. That would be a good use of your money. I don't know about safe. On the first question, so I have a very good friend, very close colleague called David Blood that runs something called Generation Investment Management. sometimes occasionally referred to in the media as blood and gore. Al Gore is the chairman of his fund. And David is one of the most passionate people in the investment world about the things you've just briefly highlighted. And David has persuaded me of the importance of the issues that you raise. And he strongly encouraged me to put in a variable in these things to account for this issue. And we had, and this was still in my Goldman days, so we had about a 2 to 3 hour session with some of their research people and some others to try and think if we could find a variable that was relevant for each country where you could, with some statistical basis, measure what you've said. And we can't. But I would like to, because I sort of share aspects of that philosophy. And it seems to me linked to the brilliant clarity of research that the Nick Stern's guys showed. From a policy perspective, or think about it from a risk management perspective, a few investments might curtail some growth, but look at the benefits. It makes a lot of sense to me. The dilemmas, I think, are sort of threefold. One I've mentioned about the statistical evidence in this period where we're all starting to focus on it. What is it you use with any confidence? Linked to that, the second thing, which is so complex and why a lot of the climate change stuff is struggling to get anywhere. How do you say to China and India, it's okay for all you guys to go saying all this fancy stuff when you've got GDP per capita of $40,000 or more, as great and as big as we are in China, ours is 7. So you expect us to have that as a priority to suit you? And I think it is only when you see the consequences of something yourself when you're going to get involved. And I quickly, as an aside, aspects of this are now much more specific, personally selfish importance to me, because I am about to embark on chairing a review orchestrated by the Prime Minister for everybody's growing resistance to antibiotics, and I've got to find some kind of global Stern-like solution. Quite why they want me and not a scientist to do it, another topic altogether, but I think it's because like climate change, it needs to be seen as an economic issue, and it's many of the same sort of things, and I've got to somewhere along the lines, once I've got the evidence, to persuade the Chinese and the Indians the same sort of thing. So I'm you know the answers, let me know, because I can translate them to that. And I think it sort of relates to a third thing which people shouldn't dismiss and has become part of the dilemma of the climate change and linked to something I was chatting with some lecturers about here and the leaders of the department. Economics is a social science. It's not a science. And there is always great dangers in emphasizing things that we think we are convinced of, what actually we don't really know, we just think that that's right. And I'll give you an example linked to what's going on with American energy and shale gas. So in 2004, another paper we wrote was called Crude, Cars, and Capital. And we applied our first ever attempted 2050 scenario to each of those markets and projected what would be the oil and energy demand, for example. And we basically suggested there would be a 15 to 20 year powerful upward shift in the demand curve that would probably put enormous pressure on energy prices. And with different degrees, you could kind of think the same in other commodities too, but it was to the core of this issue. And what is interesting is partly because of the size of the, and here maybe I'm too much of an economist, the size of the increase in oil price in itself has resulted in policy and business responses that are having a big impact on energy supply. And it's fascinating me, for me, and actually really amusing that, again, that Europe strategizes so much about this fantastic energy policy and so much focus on this, and America kind of doesn't. And because of the response to the price move, America is now transforming the global energy scene with shale gas. One of the most fascinating economic statistics for the past 2 years, Germany, this sort of leading proponent of focusing on this issue because of its importance, now turns out to be one of the biggest importers of American coal in the world. So the answer, you know, I don't know the answer, but I think you've got to make sure that the incentives for those that are not at the same stage of advancement are clear. The guy next door to you.
Thank you very much for your lecture. And do you know there is a Chinese, old Chinese saying called the 30 years to the west and the 30 years to the east. The meaning of this is time always changed. So it relates to your topic. You even predict that China will exceed the US in the 2050 in the scale of economy. So as a Chinese, I do a part of this. But I do want to know, what's the real reason why you so support and trust China? Thank you.
I heard the bit about, so the question is, why do I trust China? What was the bit before that? So spoilt? Oh, support. I am spoilt also, but not by China. So, actually, I expect China to become bigger than the US before 2030. And again, linked to why the BRIC thing became so well known is, I think initially we said 2034, and then the next time we did it, we said 2027, and I've got absolutely no reason to change that today. So, if China's not bigger than the US by 2027, come and chase me down somewhere and say, you were wrong. And it probably will be. By the way, linked to the previous question, but also to this one, and what I said about economics being a social science, as a forecaster and somebody that presided over forecasters, a lot of it to do with the challenging world of finance, I sort of know that there is no chance of 100% of what I think about the future is going to be right. 60%, that's pretty good. So there's a very good chance I'm going to be wrong, that China might not be the biggest place in the world. But so far, in the 13 years since I've embarked on this sort of path, I don't, as of yet, really see any reason to change my thinking. I worry a lot about Russia. I could talk plenty of things about that if anybody wants to ask me things about that. But at the moment, the kind of things that I read most other people talking about that worries them about China, not yet. So, but to come to the last part of your question, I could talk a lot about it, but two throwaways, which are each have their own controversy. I talked earlier about the role of the housing market in this global credit crisis. Look at what's going on in terms of property prices and policy in China today in the past 3 years. I do not know of any other country in the world, from my experience, with the possible exception of small places like Hong Kong and Singapore, that have deliberately tried to stop house prices going up. Because, and of course, in democracies, it's pretty hard to do that, especially when you've been elected and start telling everybody what great things you're going to do for the wealth of their housing wealth. But since 2010, Chinese policymakers have occasionally done quite strong things to stop house prices going up. to stop the risk of the same kind of devastating bubble that caused so much problems for the United States and the rest of the world. And as we in the UK, as people from my generation, only know too well, kind of comes around every 10 years. That is pretty impressive. Now, the second controversy with it, I guess it's probably easier to do that if you're not a democracy. That is not me saying I suggest everybody should not be a democracy, but you can't, you know, if you've got pure focus on what's right to do economic policy-wise, you kind of tend to do it. And I think one of the odd aspects, and there's many problematical things in my judgment about China not being a truer democracy than it's moving towards, but on aspects of doing the right thing for macroeconomic policy, it kind of makes it easier. You trying to tell me Alan Greenspan didn't know that house prices wouldn't go up forever? But he kind of pretended that he thought that.
I do. I just want to explore South Korea. And in your view, what weight would you give to the quality of education and higher education, the quality of higher education in economic performance across all the countries that you identified?
Right. Actually, in the original Goldman version of this, we only had education in its most simple form, and we used the measure of the number of people that were in full-time education to the age of 16. And actually, I think for many developing, for India, for example, that's hugely important. Probably, I don't know, anywhere from 1 to 350 million people that don't really get full-time education in India. And until they get closer to that, India's got no chance of achieving its full potential. But linked to the kind of nature of how I heard your question, through time, and something actually I've been heavily involved specifically with Indian economic thinkers and those close to Modi about, I think both are separately important. And higher education is separately, independently important of basic education. And I think for South Korea, it's very important.
Can I just ask you about the role of inequality in all this? A lot of people talk about inequality.
What you were going to ask me, and I'm glad you have.
And I'm just struck by the India-China comparisons. And I was reading Amartya Sen's recent book about, you know, India and its unglorious past or whatever. But the interesting thing is that without that sort of infrastructure development, without education, literacy, all these things, many of these countries, I'm assuming, weren't. And so maybe that's the secret of South Korea, that it has made great strides in reducing that inequality. And so I just want your view on what role inequality will play in this VSG index of yours and how.
We don't have inequality or the Gini coefficient directly in there. But this is actually, in my opinion, a fantastic place to finish. I was thinking I thought that's what your question was going to be. But a broader thing in before I address your specifics, I actually have some really basic, complete disagreement with the Piketty book, this book that's become so famous almost because of the brilliant style he's done it, celebrating the fact that inequalities have grown and grown and grown. It's not actually true. On a global basis, as I've pointed out to many people, as everybody knows, the UN Millennium Goal to halve poverty, 2015. On their definition, they achieved it by 2010. They didn't even know until it was pointed out to them. And it's because of some of these guys, in particular China. I joke about it, it's the first time the UN has ever achieved anything that it set out to do, and it didn't even know it had done it. So Piketty is right about focusing on inequality issues within countries, but actually for the world as a whole, we have been going through the biggest decline of inequality, that, from what I can see, known for a long period in history. So I'm glad you gave me the chance to say that, and I should have said it earlier. Second thing is, I think exactly that is the case. It is quite interesting, if you look at South Korea, it seems to be a country where there is not so much inequality. And I think there's a number of reasons why that is the case, but linked to it, they have focused a lot on doing things which are for the public good, including, generally speaking, have a pretty good infrastructure. And something that's another thing I'm currently highly immersed in is I chair a city's growth commission here in the UK, and linked to technology, digital things. You know, those who have got wealth who live in cities can somehow make sure we get access to the best. A place like South Korea makes sure everybody does. And one of the things I try to suggest to policymakers that are trying to interact with us about what we're going to say towards our final recommendations is, it's one thing having this commitment to having the fastest speed of X, Y, and Z. And of course, for business, that's really important. But as an enabler for all your people, you've got to help them get it. Particularly true in rural areas. I've done a lot of traveling around the country as part of this. And when you go to quite rural areas and you think of young people, the absence of access to technology in parts of this country is dreadful. But somewhere it's like South Korea and China. It's fantastic. In India, it's a terrible problem. So I think you're right. Final thing I would say about it is, I think going back to the Piketty thing, there is a danger, and here I may be reflective of my own career, but I'm very proud of what I've gone through and enjoyed it, is that by trying to highlight the fact that those of the highest income levels or owners of capital have benefited so much, is an issue for national taxation policy, for policymakers in those countries to deal with, but to decry it when it's coincided with and may have contributed to hundreds of millions of people being taken out of poverty, I think is outrageous. And I shall stop there. Thank you very much.